Welcome back guys to Antiparkinsonian Drugs. In last video we saw that in Parkinson's disease, dopamine activity is decreased in basal ganglia. And we also saw classification of antiparkinsonian drugs. In this video, we will see levodopa, dopa decarboxylase inhibitors and COMT inhibitors in detail. So let's start with levodopa. Levodopa is a precursor of dopamine. It's available as tablet and it's usually given orally. Its struggle to enter into the brain starts right from the intestine. Here it faces competition with other amino acids. They utilize same transport proteins for absorption, which reduces absorption of levodopa. For this reason, levodopa should be avoided with high protein meals. It should be given 30 minutes before the meal. Then it faces peripheral dopa decarboxylase enzyme. It converts most of the levodopa into dopamine in periphery. As dopamine cannot cross the blood-brain barrier, a major portion of dose is lost and not available for therapeutic action. Pyridoxine serves as cofactor for this enzyme, so it increases conversion of levodopa to dopamine. Now let's move ahead where one more obstacle is waiting for levodopa. Catechol O-methyl transferase. It degrades levodopa into 3-O-methyl dopa. This part is also lost for therapeutic action. Finally, the levodopa reaches the brain, but here amino acids again create trouble. They compete with levodopa for entry into the brain also. Moreover, 3-O-methyldopa also competes with levodopa. After this tough journey, 1-3% of levodopa enters into the brain. Here it is acted upon by dopa decarboxylase, which converts levodopa into dopamine. With this additional supply of precursor molecules from outside, lots of dopamine is synthesized by remaining healthy cells of microstriatal pathway. Thus, with extra dopamine, dopamine activity is restored in basal ganglia. This provides symptomatic relief to the patient. Hypokinesia and rigidity shows good response. However, tremors do not respond much. So this is how levodopa provides benefit in patients of Parkinson's disease. Now let's talk about adverse events with levodopa. First, the adverse events due to increased dopamine activity in brain. It produces behavioral effects like confusion, sleep disturbances, vivid dreams, depression, anxiety, delusions, hallucination, and can even precipitate schizophrenia-like syndrome. They can be treated with atypical antipsychotic drugs. Next, it causes very troublesome dyskinesia like choreoathetoid movements of limb, face, tongue, and trunk. It usually occurs after prolonged use and with high dose of levodopa. It can be relieved by decreasing the dose of levodopa, but then rigidity may worsen. So it is a very bad situation for patient. Finally, in CNS, it reduces prolactin release. Now let's move to periphery. Dopamine produced at peripheral sites produce peripheral side effects. These include postural hypotension and cardiac arrhythmias. Also, at chemoreceptor trigger zone, blood-brain barrier is broken. So dopamine produced at peripheral sites can access it. This causes nausea and vomiting. Next, it causes midriasis, which tends to occlude the aqueous outflow channels. This may precipitate an attack of glaucoma. Other adverse events associated with levodopa are altered smell and taste sensation, increased blood urea erosion, transaminase, alkaline phosphatase and bilirubin, precipitation of gout and brownish discoloration of saliva, urine and vaginal secretion. So these were all the adverse events with levodopa. Now let's talk about the response fluctuations. One is wearing off effect. See, at the initial stage of disease, patient still has enough neurons to compensate. So when you give the dose, dopamine is stored by all these neurons. This stored dopamine is gradually utilized and it lasts till the time of next dose comes. So you get smooth response in between two doses. But as the disease advances, more neurons degenerate. So now when you give the dose, you see the response for some time. But without the storage, the effect wears by the time of next dose. Then when you give the next dose, response is again seen right after the dose, but again wears off by the time of next dose. This is called wearing off effect. This fluctuation can be reduced by giving small doses more frequently. In advanced stage of disease, there can be on-off effect. In on state, patient has good mobility or even dyskinesia, and in off state, there is restricted mobility. So this was about fluctuation in response. Now let's see interaction and contraindications. Non-selective or selective MAO-A inhibitors reduce degradation of dopamine and noradrenaline. This can cause hypertensive crisis, so they should not be co-administered. Levodopa is contraindicated in psychosis, cardiac arrhythmia, and narrow angle glaucoma as it can worsen these situations. Levodopa is a precursor of melanin, so it is contraindicated in melanoma also. This is all about levodopa. Now let's move to the next drug, Dopa decarboxylase inhibitors. You know Dopa decarboxylase very well, right? Its inhibitors are carbidopa and benserazide. When this enzyme is inhibited, levodopa is spared from peripheral conversion and more can enter into the brain. It offers several advantages. First, with decarboxylase inhibitors, dose of levodopa can be reduced to 25%. It also decreases peripheral side effects of dopamine. It decreases on-off phenomenon. And finally, pyridoxine cannot increase the degeneration of levodopa as main enzyme is already inhibited. Because of these advantages, levodopa is usually given with peripheral decarboxylase inhibitors and many fixed dose combinations are also available. This is all about this group. Now the last group for the video, COMT inhibitors. See, as such, most of the levodopa is lost due to action of dopa decarboxylase and very small amount is lost due to COMT. However, when you give decarboxylase inhibitors, degradation by COMT increases. Moreover, the metabolite 3-O-methyldopa competes with levodopa for entry in brain. This nuisance of COMT can be controlled by tolcapone and entacapone. They inhibit COMT, so this loss is prevented and more levodopa is diverted to enter into the brain. The tolcapone can enter in brain and inhibit COMT over there also. This again diverts more levodopa for synthesis of dopamine. Moreover, it also prevents degradation of dopamine. Entacapone has no CNS activity. When added to the combination of levodopa and carbidopa, these drugs further reduce the required dose of levodopa. They also smoothen the wearing off and on-off effects. Tolcapone is associated with severe liver toxicities. Thus, usually entacapone is preferred among these two. That's it for this video. We will see the remaining drugs in next video. If you found this video helpful, please share it with your friends. Thanks for watching. See you in next video.